Before I begin this morning, I want to first of all thank you, young man, for your service. I won't ask you to stand and embarrass yourselves, but if you're here today and you've served in uniform, would you raise your hand? Thank you all for your service. Thank you for everything that you've done. Tomorrow, you know, the sad thing is so many of our friends and family think tomorrow is all about sunshine and barbecues, but let's take a little bit of time out tomorrow just to remember those that, you know, there's an old saying in the military, all gave some and some gave all. And let's remember those who gave all. If you got your Bibles with you, and I certainly hope you do, otherwise you're in the wrong place, go with me to 2 Timothy chapter 2. I double dog dare you. 2 Timothy chapter 2. As you're turning there, I want to share a little bit about, I have this affinity towards Timothy. And there's a couple of reasons why. 1 and 2 Timothy were written during Paul's second imprisonment. Now, there's a huge difference between his first imprisonment and his second imprisonment. When Paul was in prison the first time, you can read Colossians, you can read Galatians, you can read Philippians, and he's pretty convinced that he's going to get out. He's going to survive, and he's going to continue ministering. And he goes through this internal battle at one point where he says, is it better to die and be with Christ or to live and minister to you? He said, but either way, I'll see you again. But the second time he wound up in prison, he knew he wasn't going to get out. And so he began to make some preparations. And what he did was he assigned some of his young followers to oversee the churches in Samaria. Titus, a young man by the name of Titus, he sent him to Crete, which is in Greece. And he was overseeing all of the churches of Crete. Well, Timothy, who was his protege, all right, parents, you're going to disagree with me publicly, and that's okay, you're allowed to, but internally you know the truth. The parents always say, well, I don't have a favorite, I love all my children the same. That's not true, there's one of them you love more than the others. Timothy was the one that Paul loved more than the others. And he put him in charge of all the churches in Ephesus. And then he wrote him these two letters to teach him how to lead these churches in Ephesus. And understand that Ephesus was a very difficult place to be a Christian, much less a Christian leader. It was the Las Vegas of its time. It was a rough place to try and be a Christian. And Paul selected Timothy to be the leader over those churches. As a matter of fact, he even tells Timothy, let no one despise you of your youth. Just because he was young does not mean he wasn't qualified. And then Paul gives him this instruction in 2 Timothy chapter 2. We begin in verse 1. Listen to what he says. He says, you therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have learned from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, he's not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. And the hardworking farmer must be the first to partake of his crops. Consider what I say, and may the Lord give you understanding in all things. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together, to dig into your word, to delve into your word. And I pray, Father, as a result, your word would abide in us. I pray, Father, that you would bless and honor this time that we spend together as we seek to do your will, as we seek to do what you have called us to do. And Father, I do pray there's a number of people, including our pastor, who have suffered loss this week, that have had to deal with unexpected and difficult circumstances. Father, your word that we're studying today talks about our strength that comes from you, and I pray, Father, that that strength would be on each and every one, even those who are dealing with something that's not public. I pray, Father, that you would minister to our pastor and his family during this time, and the rest that have suffered loss or dealing with difficulties, hardships. Lord, I just pray that your will would be done and you would be glorified in us. In the name of Christ. Amen. And so Paul starts us off. He says, you therefore, my son. Now let me tell you what I'm glad that Paul doesn't say. You ready? I'm glad he doesn't say, you therefore, my son, be strong. Period. That never works out. I've always said that one of the greatest lies ever told to the American people is the lie of willpower. I've got a C.S. Lewis quote that I love. He said, no man knows how bad he really is until he's tried very hard to be good. Anyone in here ever experienced anything like that? Here's an example of the lie of willpower. Are you ready for this? I just looked this up this morning. Jenny Craig is worth $300 million. Anyone in here ever tried to quit doing something? Anyone ever tried to start doing something? How many people in here have ever made a New Year's resolution and it lasted more than 13 minutes? Willpower is a lie. But Paul is not telling Timothy to pull himself up by his bootstraps, buck up. You know, he's not telling him any of that. Listen to what he says. He says, you therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. See, it's not our strength that matters. As a matter of fact, the Word of God tells me that God's strength is perfected in my weakness. It's not our strength that we're counting on. And if it is, then we need to reconfigure, rethink our walk with the Lord. Because every time, I can tell you this, I'm going to testify, every time I've ever tried to do something in my own strength, I wound up flat on my face. Every time, without exception. When I was in seminary, and I was absolutely certain, mess around and bump the mic, I was absolutely certain that God had called me into ministry. Absolutely certain. And I was in second or third year of Greek, I'm not sure which. We were assigned an exegetical paper. The seminarians in the group will know what I'm talking about. It's when you take the original language and you break it down, you study each and every word, you draw diagrams of it, you do grammatical analysis of it. I mean, it's really deep, intensive work. And I picked 1 Peter 5, 1 through 4, because it's one of the verses that I base my ministry on. And as I'm studying this, I came across something that terrified me so much that I literally thought about dropping out of seminary, quitting the ministry, and going and find a factory job somewhere. And it's when Peter said, shepherd the flock of God which has been entrusted to you. And that terrified me. It absolutely terrified me. And as I was contemplating this, I was thinking, these are souls that are so precious to God that he allowed his son to be tortured and murdered for them. And then he says, here, Clay, you take care of them. No! God, you know me. I can't be trusted with that. I shouldn't be trusted with a raw egg. I'm an idiot. I know I'm an idiot. God knows I'm an idiot. Why would he put me in that position? And I battled with that. All the way up until the point, days, that I heard that still small voice whisper in my ear that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. If ever I try to do something, if ever I try to do anything on my own, I know what the outcome is going to be. But Paul doesn't tell Timothy, be strong. He says, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. By the way, I know some of you guys just groan when you hear something like this, but there's something in the original language that you have to know about that word, be strong. And it's this, that it's in the passive voice. In other words, it's not actively be strong, it's receive the strength. Be empowered. Then he goes on. Verse 2, this is, by the way, this is a part of being strong. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these things to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. The things that you've heard, the things that you've learned, commit these to other faithful men. Here's what Paul is telling Timothy. You ready for this? Timothy, you cannot do it by yourself. When I was in seminary, I went to seminary in San Diego, California. Don't be jealous. And there in San Diego is the Scripps Oceanic Institute. It's one of the most premier oceanic schools on the planet. Now, and some friends of mine and I went for a tour one time. We were all seminarians. We went on this tour of this place, and it was really fascinating. They had examples of the coelacanth that had washed up on shore. I mean, you could actually see this thing. It was amazing. And we came around this corner, we had this tour guide, and we came to an aquarium, and it was a pretty good sized aquarium, and in the aquarium was a great white shark. He was about that long. And the tour guide said, "How old do you think that shark is?" And I raised my hand. I said, 6 months? He said, "No, that shark is 14 years old." See, a shark will never grow any larger than its environment will allow. He said, "Now, even though this is a fully mature shark, if we took it out of this tank and put it in a larger tank, he would grow. And if we put him in a larger tank than that, he would grow again. And if we released him to the wild, he'd grow to full size." A shark can never grow any larger than its environment will allow. Neither will a ministry. The problem is, so many people in ministry, they're lone rangers. There's a pride in perfectionism. Anyone recognize that? There's a pride. I had to deal with this when I first got into ministry because, see, there's two ways to do things. There's my way and the wrong way. And so I would delegate, but then I would micromanage those who I delegated. And it got to the point that you get so burned out, and you what you're doing is you're restricting the ministry that God has given you. What you're doing when you don't allow men and women to grow, you know, Ephesians chapter 4 defines the job of the pastor teacher, and that is to equip the saints so that they can do the work of the ministry and the body of Christ can be edified. And so Paul is telling Timothy, you can't do this by yourself. Commit these things to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. And then he says this, and Paul uses three illustrations to get his point across. Number one, verse 3, "You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." It's funny, we were just talking this morning, brother and I, about basic training and how it's changed over the years. I went to basic training in 1988. The drill sergeants were still punching us. Not so much anymore, huh?
No.
Of course, I was in the Army, too, you know. I don't want to embarrass you, but what made you choose the Air Force over the military? I'm about to get run down, Pastor. I may need some backup. So, back in that, you know, basic training is intentionally arduous. The whole point of basic training is to break you down further than you ever thought you could be broken so that they can lift you up higher than you ever realized you could go. So that you can realize that you can accomplish and do more than you ever thought you could. And so Paul is telling Timothy, you're going to have to endure hardships. And by the way, notice what it doesn't say here. It doesn't say if you endure hardships. The fact is, hardships are not an if, they're a when. We are all going to endure hardships. We're all going to have difficulty in our life. There's this false gospel that is taught in some churches. I call it the ooey gooey, icky sticky, sloppy agape, cotton candy gospel. And it's that gospel that says, if you come to the Lord Jesus Christ, all your problems will float away like butterflies on the breeze. Find that in Scripture. You know what Jesus told the disciples? Follow me, and you're going to have trials, tribulations, persecutions. It's not going to be easy. It's a very narrow path. It's a very difficult path, but he also promised them, lo, I will be with you always. I will never leave you nor forsake you. I would rather live through hell on earth than hell for eternity. I would rather have difficulties and trials and here now in this life that is but a vapor, knowing that I have a heavenly reward waiting for me. But the thing is, it's not all about just the heavenly reward. Remember, Jesus said, I came so that you might have life and have it abundantly in the here and now. And so Paul tells him, you have to endure hardship, and it will come. And keep in mind, again, Ephesus was not an easy town to be a believer in. I had a friend. All my stories today seem to be going back to seminary. I had a friend when I was in seminary. Her name was Sandy Herder. She was the secretary to the president, and I worked on seminary grounds at the same time that I was a student. And so she and I developed this friendship, and Sandy told me her story one day, and it absolutely was heartbreaking. Sandy came to San Diego with her husband from Salt Lake City, Utah, and they were very high-profile members of the Mormon Church. So much so that her husband was one of the leaders in their local congregation. And she worked at the bank. She was a vice president at the bank. You know, they had their home, they had their vehicles, they'd raised their family. And one day, Sandy was studying the Word of God, apart from the literature. And she suddenly realized that there was a mistake, not in the Word of God, but with the doctrine of the Mormon Church. And so she went to the, I forget what they call them, president of the congregation, I think. And she said, I've got something I want to share. And she had shared before, so they thought, no problem. So she gets up into the pulpit in front of all of these people, and she begins to explain what she's discovered. And before very long, she was physically, violently removed, not only from the stage, but out the front door of the building, and they grabbed her husband, and they threw him out as well, and told them never come back, that they are disfellowshipped, and they're not allowed back in the Mormon church anywhere in the United States. That was on Sunday. On Monday, she wakes up to a phone call. She's no longer needed on her job at the bank. And by the way, your mortgage is due, and so are all your vehicles. We're either going to foreclose or you're going to pay. They lost everything. Absolutely everything. That's what it was like in Ephesus. If you were an Ephesian and you became a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, you lost everything. It was not an easy place. So hardship was going to come. Then he goes on, verse 4. Listen to how he describes this. He says, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself in the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Christmas Day, 1990. I was in Hafr al-Batin, Saudi Arabia, on the northern Saudi Arabia, southern Iraqi border. I was a military police officer, and I was in my Humvee. I was up in the gunner's pit, had a M2 50 caliber machine gun. Anyone in here ever get the chance to play with the Maldus? Yeah, she speaks loud, doesn't she? Probably about 11:30 at night, I suddenly realized that somebody was shooting at me. And so I began returning fire, which is what I was trained to do. Christmas Day, I'm in the middle of a firefight. And by the way, the irony of that was not lost on me in the moment. Day that we should be celebrating the birth of our Lord, and here I am doing this. As the enemy was shooting at me, and as I was shooting back, I can tell you with absolute certainty, not one time did it cross my mind, I wonder if my electric bill got paid this month. There's a saying in the Army, you can probably apply this to the Air Force too. There's a saying in the Army, a distracted soldier is a dead soldier. Listen to what the Apostle Paul tells Timothy. He says, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself in the affairs, in the minutiae, in the dumb stuff of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Every one of us have been called into combat. You may not realize that. That's the funny thing about it. So few Christians understand the war that is going on. And I'm not even talking about politically and in society. I'm talking about in the spiritual realm. People don't understand what Paul was talking about in Ephesians chapter 6 when he told you to get geared up and dressed for battle. People don't understand today that what we in America, don't get me wrong, I love this country and I'm grateful to be here. There's nowhere else I'd rather be. But we in the Christian church in America have become spoiled. Mm-hmm. I remember when I was a pastor in Warwick, Missouri, our air conditioner went out, and the deacons voted to cancel service because no one would come anyway. We have gotten so spoiled. Now, there's some people in this congregation that have had the opportunity to go to South Africa and talk to some of the believers over there. You want to talk about a group of people that are willing to endure in order to hear the Word of God preached. We are so spoiled in this country. When we had a Korean missionary come and speak at chapel one time and in seminary, and he actually told us that the South Korean Christian church is praying that persecution would come to the shores of the United States to wake up the church. It's a great old saint by the name of Tertullian who said the blood of the saints is the seed of the church. Does any wonder why our church is struggling so much in this country? He says, no one engaged in warfare. We are in battle, ladies and gentlemen. Entangles himself in the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Then he says this, verse 5. If anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. Any athletes in the room? No? Oh, we got one back there. Here we go. I like to watch the Summer Olympics. It's every 4 years. I like the Winter Olympics too. But think about this. Let's say it's a 400-meter dash, right? And everybody is lined up in the starting blocks, and the gun goes off, and everybody takes off running, and they're all going around the track except for one guy that cuts across the middle of the field and crosses the finish line. Does he get the gold medal around his neck? No. The fact is, we do not see the reward unless we do it the right way. First, he tells us that we need to be strong. Second, he tells us we need to be focused. And now he tells us we need to do the right thing the right way each and every time. The fact is, there are shorter ways to get things done. But in my 51 years, I have learned a lesson. And I'm going to give it to you for free. You ready for this? Shortcuts rarely are. Shortcut. How many of you remember hearing the news stories? This has happened, especially when GPS really first started coming out. You already know where I'm going with this. There's a news story about some poor family that's trying to get through a snowstorm, and next thing they know, they're in this valley completely snowed in because GPS said that was a shortcut. Shortcuts rarely are. And so he says, in order to receive the crown, in order to receive the reward, we must compete according to the rules. So we need to be strong, we need to be focused, and we need to have integrity. We have to be the kind of people that are going to do the right thing even if we think nobody's watching. We have to be the kind of people that will do the right thing even if we think there's no one else that sees us. One thing that we all need to understand is that there's an entire world out there that the minute you raise your hand and say you're a Christian, they're watching you. And they're waiting. And they're rooting for your failure. They want to see you stumble and fall because that gives them the right to step back and say, see, there's no difference between them and us. There are people out there that celebrate in the failures of Christians. If you don't believe me, just remember some of the news stories we saw years and years ago. I won't mention their names, but there were some predominant television evangelists that one right after the other went down hard, and the media just celebrated it. We have to compete according to the rules. Then he goes on, he uses his last illustration. Number 6, the hardworking farmer must be the first to partake of his crops. First he tells us to be strong, then he tells us to be focused, then he tells us to have integrity, and then he establishes the value of hard work. One of the things that a lot of people don't realize, again, in this Christian walk is it's not easy. It's not always easy to be a Christian because sometimes we have to make choices that are uncomfortable. There is a video. If you get a chance to watch it, I recommend that you do. How many of you are familiar with Penn Teller, the magician? Well, Penn Teller is an absolute avid atheist. He's very open about his atheism. He loves to talk about his atheism. But he's got this video online. And where he talks about, it was after a show, a man came up to him and gave him a Gideon Bible. And Penn Teller begins talking about the concept of proselytizing. And Penn Teller, this atheist, says, I have no respect for somebody who has a religious viewpoint that doesn't proselytize. Because if you truly believe that there's a difference between heaven and hell, if you truly believe that there's an opportunity for eternal life, he said this. The atheist said this. He said, how much would you have to hate someone not to tell them? And he goes on, he gives an illustration. He says, if there's a bus barreling down the road and heading straight towards you, and I'm telling you, look out, the bus is coming, even if you don't believe it, there comes a point I'm going to physically tackle you and move you out of the way of the bus. And he says, how much do you have to hate somebody not to tell them the truth? Isn't that amazing that an atheist has a better understanding? And the reason I brought it up is because there's a point in there where he says that there are Christians that will not share their faith because they're afraid it might make it socially awkward. It's not always easy being a Christian. Sometimes it becomes very difficult. But listen to what he says. He says, the hardworking farmer must be the first to partake of his crops. Number one, he's a hardworking man or woman. And number two, he receives the reward of his work. You've heard me talk about it before, but one of the things that I just love to meditate on is the Bema Seat. You know, there are two thrones in Scripture. There's the great white throne of judgment. Now, the good news is, if you're here today and you have trusted in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ to save you from your sins, then you will never stand before the great white throne judgment. That's where the unbelieving world will stand. They will stand before the great white throne, and Scripture says they will be judged for every thought, word, and deed. Even my thought life, if I weren't a believer, would be on display. The individual at the great white throne judgment is judged. The Bema Seat's different. That's where believers stand. And Paul tells us that the Bema Seat, we're not judged. Our works are judged. Everything that I've ever done for the sake and in the name of Jesus Christ will be judged. It will be tried as by fire. Everything that I did hoping that pastor would see it and pat me on the back, that's wood, hay, and stubble. That burns up. But everything that I do because I love people and I love Jesus is going to be refined as gold, silver, and precious stones. And I'm going to kneel down before that Bema Seat. And he's going to place that crown on my head, and he's going to say those words, well done, good and faithful servant. And then the most important part comes. When we're gathered around the throne, and we take those crowns off that he gave us, and we throw them at his feet as one last offering, one last sacrifice. What an amazing day that's going to be. What a thrilling day that's going to be. We're going to see people that you don't even... You're not even expecting. You're going to see people that receive crowns that are too big for their heads because everything they've done quietly and behind the scenes and faithfully for years and years and years. Billy Graham one time said that if you think his crown is going to be something, you should see the crown of the Sunday school teacher that led him to the Lord. We will receive the reward of our hard work in the end. God is faithful. And he will not withhold from us that reward. Peter describes it in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4. He says, and we will receive a crown of glory that never fades away. So he says we've got the soldier who's strong and focused. We have the athlete who has integrity. We have the worker, the farmer who has a work ethic. And then he says this, I love Paul. I love this catch-all. Paul has all these catch-alls. By the way, those of you that are in the military, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. Every job description in the United States military ends with the same line, and other duties as assigned. So there's no one in the military that can go, well, Sergeant, that's not my job. And other duties as assigned. Paul does that a lot. There's one point where he goes through this entire list of heinous sins, and at the end of it, he says, and if there's anything else that's contrary to sound doctrine. And he does it here. Listen to what he says. He says, consider what I say. Ponder it. Think about it. Think about these examples that I've given you. Think about the strength that you receive from your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about the strength that abides in you in the person of the Holy Spirit. Consider what I say. And may the Lord give you understanding in all things. Is that not an amazing prayer? It's a short, sweet, simple, profound prayer. And may the Lord give you understanding in all things. If you're here and you've trusted in the gospel, if you've ever found yourself at the foot of a bloodstained cross and you trusted in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, you are indwelt by God the Holy Spirit, who endeavors, who desires to teach you all the deep things of God. He wants to teach you everything that you need. He's just waiting until you're ready. You know, if God dumped all of the knowledge that he wanted to give you into your brain at one time, I really believe your head would probably explode. So he gives it to us as we're ready. Jesus gave us an example of that. I always love this story. You know, he was crucified, he was buried, he was raised again from the dead. He walked with the disciples for 40 days, off and on. 40 days he spent with them. And they're out on the mountaintop, and he gives them some last little bit of instruction, and then he looks at him and says, "There's so much more I wanted to teach you, but you're just not ready." And then he ascended. And what I love about the story is these guys are standing out there, staring at the clouds. We don't know how long, but it was long enough that God felt it necessary to send an angel saying, "Men of Galilee, why do you stare at the clouds?" The Holy Spirit operates the same way. I'm going to give you a little tidbit that may be encouraging to you. The Holy Spirit has two primary functions that he has in the life of a believer. One is teaching and one is grieving. When we're outside of the will of God, when we're doing the things we're not supposed to be doing, he grieves within us. And it's for the purpose of drawing us back into that relationship. But when we're in relationship with the Father, he's teaching us. He's illuminating the Word to us. How many of you have ever been studying through a passage of Scripture that you've read 990 times before, and all of a sudden something leaps off the page and you have that eureka moment? Wow, I never knew that was there. Every time that happens, you should be encouraged, because that's evidence that you have grown in your spiritual maturity since the last time you read that passage. You have grown to the point that the Holy Spirit could illuminate that to you. May the Lord give you understanding in all things. Stand with me as we pray. You are our God. You are our Father. You are our strength, our wisdom, our discernment, our power. You are the Lord of lords, the King of kings. You're the King of glory. Father, we are so incredibly grateful for this opportunity to be together, to dig into your word. And Father, I pray that you would bless this time that we've had together. Father, I pray that we would become a people that are strong in your spirit, focused in that which you called us to do. That, Father, we would be a people of integrity, a people that are not afraid to roll up our sleeves and do the work. And Father, I pray for everyone that's assembled here today that, as Paul said, you would give them understanding in all things. Give us understanding in all things. Father, again, I pray for those in our family, in our church family, that are grieving today. Those that are struggling, those that are dealing with difficulties. I pray, Father, that this strength that comes from you would be so evident in them that others would have to give you the glory for it. I pray, Father, that your will would be done perfectly and miraculously among us each moment of our day. We honor you, Lord, and we thank you, and it's in the amazing, powerful, perfect, exciting name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. If you're here today and there's anything going on that you want prayer for, that you're seeking the strength that we've been talking about, then I invite you to come forward. If you're here today and all of this was grief to you, the fact is you know that you don't know Christ. You haven't trusted in that gospel. That I don't just encourage you, I implore you to come forward today. If you're here today and you just have something on your heart that you want to share, as we listen to the music, the Lord moves. I